Hey, Lead Up listeners, Mike Harbour. Another great episode. This is episode 404 of the Lead Up podcast. I'm going to talk to you today about the most contagious element in your organization. When I do that, I'm going to talk to you about leadership, the three people that are most important for you to lead, so you make sure this contagious element doesn't infect the organization in the wrong way, but the right way. And then we're going to talk to you about your personal leadership and how to make sure that you're in charge of how this element spreads as well. Thanks for tuning into the Lead Up podcast. If you're a returning listener, appreciate your support. I hope you continue to find value in what we share with you. One of the great ways you can help me is to share your thoughts on your listening platform. What do you think about the Lead Up podcast? Give us a star rating. That helps us get noticed a little bit more out in the marketplace. Also, share this with your colleagues that you lead with. Help others. One of the ways that you can help others grow is to share information like this. When you hear something that's valuable for you, if you find this valuable, or any other of our podcasts, or even our interviews that we do with other leaders, share it with them. And let me give you one last tidbit. How to use the Lead Up podcast to grow. I would set aside time weekly. Obviously, we release a new episode every Friday, but maybe you set aside time weekly, 15 minutes, 30 minutes, to listen to the Lead Up podcast, maybe 30 or 40 minutes for the interviews. Typically, these teaching lessons that I'm going to do, like today, are about 20 minutes. Set aside time. If you hear an episode that you really love, that you think would help you in developing your team members that you lead, set aside a lunch and learn time for them. Bring everybody into the same room. Let's listen to this podcast together and then roundtable discuss that after you've had a time to listen. They're typically about 20 minutes, so you can do that, eat lunch, have great conversation, and then send everybody else off inspired to go back to work. So there's your leadership tip of the day of how to really use a podcast to grow and grow your team and develop those around you without having to pay for leadership development. This is a free way to be able to do that because we don't charge for the Lead Up podcast as of right now. Hey, thanks so much for tuning in. Let's jump in. I want to talk again about the most contagious element. The most contagious element you've got to be aware of in your leadership and in your organization. Let me start with this. I read this somewhere. I don't remember where, but I want to share it with you and see if you can figure it out. This is always a player on your team. It is the advanced man or woman of our true selves. Its roots are inward, but its fruit is outward. It is our best friend or our worst enemy. It is more honest and consistent than our words. It is an outward look on past experiences. It is a thing which draws people to us or repels them away from us. It is never content until it is expressed. It is the librarian of our past. It is the speaker of our future. It is the speaker of our present. It is the prophet of our future. What is it? Think about that for a minute. As a leader, what is it? What is this thing, this element that I'm talking about? Are you ready? It's attitude. Now, you probably knew that or you had some understanding of where I was going, but attitude is the most contagious element, the most contagious thing that you deal with in your organization. Now, oftentimes, we point fingers at other things, like we need to raise revenue, we got a turnover issue, we got people not showing up to work, we got people mistreating each other, but at its roots, all of those things, at their roots, is attitude. What is attitude? It's often a paradigm. It's a perspective of how people look through things. It's like a lens at which they look through life. Think about this for a minute. There were two prisoners who were looking through the bars. One saw mud, the other saw stars. Sitting on the same side, but one saw mud, one saw stars. That's a perspective. It's a lens at which one looks at things. This is where attitude comes from. And as a leader, you have to be ultra aware of the attitude that's permeating your team, your department, your organization. Where does it begin? Where does attitude begin? Well, I believe it begins between our ears first. It begins between your ears, begins between my ears. So this is not going to be a mental health session today, but we all need some of that once in a while. But since we're talking about leadership, attitude begins with you. It begins with you, the leader. It begins with your attitude. And since attitude is contagious and it permeates itself through the organization, through the team, through the department, your attitude as the leader is the most important attitude on the team. And maybe you understand that. Maybe you don't like hearing that. Maybe you already have a great attitude, but maybe you're looking at things going on your team. They're not performing at the level you want them to perform or you need them to perform, but maybe you haven't looked at yourself yet. You haven't looked at that inward root. Remember I said it's roots are inward, but its fruit is outward. When we want an attitude to change around us, when we have a team of people around us, we first need to look within, look at ourselves, look at our own attitude. What attitude are we carrying that may be permeating the rest of the organization? Because that their attitude often is going to be a reflection of my attitude, our attitude, your attitude. Now, I'm not saying that you're not going to have some sour attitudes on the team, some sour apples, as they say in the apple cart. But if you haven't looked at yours first, make sure you do that. What we must do is we have to set expectations for attitude. It's a contagion, remember. It infects the rest of the team. It works its way through. And if we allow poor attitudes on the team, we know eventually that contagion is going to work its way through the rest of our team. We often label it as burnout. We label it as engagement or poor engagement. But oftentimes it's an inner attitude. It's an inner root that we haven't dealt with as a leader. So how do we do that from a leadership perspective, from an organizational perspective? How do we begin to work on the attitude of our team? Well, I believe we have to hold firm to a core set of team values. If you haven't established solid core values for your team, I recommend you go to Amazon and look me up. Look up Mike Harbour. Look up my author page and look for a book titled Quit Losing Talent, Expanded Edition. It's my latest book we published earlier this year. And make sure you get the expanded edition, because it's got all of the things that I often talk about from a leadership perspective in there. It's got the tools. It's got 20 tactics in there for you to work on. But the very first tactic in that book is a tactic called target check your values. So if you don't have a solid core set of team, department, or organizational values, I believe you need to begin right there, even for yourself. Because what values do is they allow us a target to point people toward. It's not enough to say, hey, Mike, you need to have a better attitude. Hey, Mike, when you come to work tomorrow, make sure you bring a good attitude with you. Now, when we do that, most people are going to say, my attitude is fine. You need to tell everybody else about their attitude. I remember growing up, my dad would often tell me, boy, you need to get a better attitude. He didn't ever tell me what that meant. He just said, you need to have a better attitude. I'm like, my attitude's fine. What do I do? Maybe it's your attitude. And again, there's some truth to both of that. I had a bad attitude, but maybe he did as well. But there was never any description of what a better attitude looked like. And one of the ways, the best way, the greatest way to point people toward having a better attitude is to have a set of core values that when someone gets out of alignment with, you set behavior and expectations around those values. And when you see their attitude not in alignment with what your expectations are, with what the behaviors are, you can point them back to that. Hey, Mike, one of our values here is excellence. Help me understand how the way you just talk to your coworker, how you talk to that customer, how does that align up? How does that line up with that value? How does that line up with the expectations that we've talked about and discussed before? Now, this is meaning you got to not only have a set of core values, you've got to talk about them. You've got to share them with your team. Help them understand what it looks like to be an employee of excellence, be a team member of excellence, be a good teammate, have integrity, trust, commitment, relentlessness, reliance, unity. If you look behind me, I've got my values on the wall. Many of my values, my core values for my team: ignite, drive, united, action. These are all value words. Now, if you go to my website, go to the About Us tab, you can see those values, how they're defined, and then how we have set expectations for each other in our company, in our organization, to live up to those. And then we hold each other accountable to those values. I can't just say you need to have a better attitude. You need to have an attitude check. Now, let's have a values check. How are we doing there? Now, if you haven't done that as a leader, I recommend, again, you grab a copy of the book. The instructions are there. We also have a digital course for Quit Losing Talent. You can buy the entire course, or you can buy just the Target Check Your Values tactic. You get the toolkit for that tactic. You've got a copy of the book. You get a video. That video, I'm not sure how long it is for that particular tactic, but it's going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 to 45 minutes. And I'll teach you exactly how to target check your values with your team. And you get a toolkit of how to do that. So if that's something you need to do, look, you can buy that one tactic. Go to our website, harbourresources.com. You can buy the entire strategy for that strategy that target check your values falls within. Or you can buy the entire course. We'll give you those options on our webpage as well. Hopefully that'll help you. Again, I'm helping you here on this podcast. Now, there's three team members we have to lead well. Okay, when we think about attitude and we want to improve attitude, we want to make sure that if it is contagious, it's a positive contagion, not a negative contagion. So there's three people, three types of employees that we have to lead really well. Number one is what I call the more seasoned employee, the older employee, the more tenured employee, the employee that's been with us a long time. Now, I've worked with hundreds and hundreds, thousands really, of leaders across the country. I've worked with hundreds of organizations. I was in the Army for a long time. We used to call the old soldiers in the Army road soldiers, R-O-A-D. And that was an acrostic or an acronym, because we love acronyms in the military. We love acronyms in the world. But ROAD stood for Retired on Active Duty. So what these older soldiers were, they may have been in 15, 16, 17 years. They were getting really close to their retirement date of 20 years, because in the military you can retire after 20 if you want. And they were getting really close to that. And so what they would do is they would just retire while they were on active duty. They would do, they were untouchable. I don't agree with that. I think everybody should be touchable, be held accountable, or be let go, be removed from the team. I believe that, because, well, I'll get into that as we talk more about this person. But if you've got more seasoned employees on your team, this is a real opportunity for you, or a real danger zone for you. Because often in my experience, I see older employees, more seasoned employees. I've got a couple of clients I'm thinking of right now as we speak. They've got someone that's been on the team a long time, and they mistreat the next generation. They mistreat the less seasoned employee. They mistreat the inexperienced employee. And right now, I don't know if you're experiencing this in your team or your organization. Turnover is at a crazy level. We're losing people in the first 30, 60, 90 days, and that 12-month mark, faster than we ever have in history. And in my conversations, a lot of what's driving it is this right here. We have not challenged our more seasoned employees or more tenured employees to be good agents of our values, to be good exemplars of our values, to be good teachers and trainers of that next generation, to set a great example for that great for that next generation. Look, I don't know if you know this or not, the next generation is going to be serving you, whatever organization or industry you're in, that next generation is going to be serving you when you're done. What kind of legacy are you going to leave within them? Are they going to be a great servant to you because you were a great servant to them from your experience and your training, your modeling, your example, the way you talked to them, the way you treated them? Or are you just going to say, I had to learn it the hard way, they should too, and I'm not going to help them at all? Guess what? Treat me that way. I may not treat you very well when you come in for service. Now, I say that in jest because of a core value for me is excellence, and I'm going to be excellence. I'm going to do things in an excellent way no matter what. But I'm probably going to remind you how you treated me while I'm treating you well. Probably going to bring that up. Because I have a high level of expectation for myself and for others. So, again, if you're a leader and you've got more seasoned employees and you've got a turnover issue, this may be one of those roots that you need to look at. Do you have as seasoned employees mistreating our younger generations and running them off? We can blame the younger generation all we want. They're not going anywhere. They're the workforce of the future. And by the way, you're the parents of that generation. You raised them. Do you want them to be successful? Or do you want to mistreat them? Do you want to microaggress, micro-bully them? Do you want to help them be better, to be the best, so when you need their service, they serve you well? So the first employee is that more seasoned employee. The second employee is the new employee. When should that new employee learn about attitude, learn about your values? That new employee should learn about these things during the interview process. You should be talking about these expectations, these behaviors that you expect during the interview process, not after you hire them, not after their 90-day period, not after they've had a failure, but during the interview process. And you start setting these expectations because we want them to know that we're going to lead them, we're going to hold the bar high, and we expect, by the way, all our employees to do that as well, because we've had this conversation with their team members that they're going to be joining, to include the more seasoned employees. We're holding everybody accountable to this level of responsibility, this level of excellence and attitude. And then we coach them up in that first 90 days. We coach them up. Not only are we coaching skill set, we're coaching behavioral set as well. Like, how do we want them to behave? And when they get a little bit off on the shoulder and there's when you're driving down the road, those ridges that make noise, when they get a little bit off the road and there's a little friction there, you bring them back. Hey, one of our values is excellence. We need to get you back in alignment with that. How are you going to show up tomorrow? How are you going to communicate with your team members? How are you going to talk to our customers? We just bring them back to that. Those new employees are going to bring their own attitudes. They're going to bring their own behaviors and habits. They're going to bring their own values. But we have a set of expectations and values here within our organization that we need them to fall in alignment with, or they're just not a good fit. They may have the skill set, but they don't have the values fit. And so this is how you begin to establish attitudinal boundaries and barriers. Not that we're trying to handcuff people. No, that's not it at all. We're trying to lead them well and raise the bar for them and raise the bar for our entire team. So you've got the more tenured employee, you've got the newer employee, and in the middle of that, we've got the negative employee. Maybe you've hired somebody, or maybe you inherited somebody, they've been on the team a little while, and they're just negative. Again, we're going to bring them to our values. We're going to continually coach them. We're going to give them what I call benefit of the doubt. We're going to continue to raise the bar for them. We're going to coach them up, or we're going to coach them out. Doesn't mean they're a bad person. They're just bad for our team. And why is that important? We coach them out. We coach them up. Look, we're going to spend some time coaching them up. If we can't get them there, we eventually have to coach them out off the team. Why do we do that? Because attitude is the most contagious element in your organization. Negativity spreads way faster than positivity. And so when you have a negative employee, if you want that element, that behavior, that threat to your team to infiltrate the team, then leave it alone. If you don't, coach up or coach out. Remove the toxin, so to speak, from your team. One final thing I want to leave you with here. It begins with you. I shared that earlier. It's between our ears, right? Number one, we've got to own it. We've got to own our own attitude first, because our team is going to be a reflection of that. Now, does that mean you've got to be a cheerleader every day? No. What it does mean is before you get out of the car and you walk into your department, into your office, into your organization, before you have a meeting with others, whatever attitude you're bringing to work is what they're going to pick up on. If you're bringing a bad attitude to work, I recommend you open the back door of your car before you walk in. Hang that negative attitude up on the coat hanger in the back seat. If you want to put it back on when you get in the car and carry it home with you, then do that. I don't recommend that. Just don't carry it into the workplace with you, for sure. I wouldn't carry it home with you either. I'd just throw it out the window. So you've got to own the responsibility of that. The other thing you've got to do is you've got to understand it. Like, you need to develop your emotional intelligence. Like, what triggers your negative attitude? Because, look, we all get it. You see the best of me here. You hear the best of me on the podcast. There are times I have bad days, bad moments. I need to understand what triggers that and make sure that I deal with that and not let that become a contagion within my team. And then finally, I need to develop it. How do I develop it? I develop it by practicing gratitude. Sometimes when I'm in a funk and I've had a day or three that are not good, I just restart a gratitude practice. Like, I start thinking my Creator for all the good things that are going on around me. What are five things that I'm grateful for? What are five things that I'm good at? What are five things that my team does? What are five reasons I love my job? Whatever those things are, just a practice of gratitude. You'll eventually, that gratitude will take over and infect you and your attitude as well. Look, you got to deal with this. We got a major issue with attitude in the world today. You're the leader. Everything rises and falls on leadership. Make sure you create attitudes that are rising above the negativity that's going on in the world. Hey, this has been Mike Harbour, episode 404 on the Lead Up Podcast. Share this with others. Leave us a review. Thanks for visiting. Make sure you go get a copy of our book, Quit Losing Talent, the expanded edition. We'll see you on the next episode of the Lead Up Podcast.